Hello, I'm Jennifer Wise. I'm a member of Holy Spirit Catholic Community. Usually at this time, we're having our Theology on Tap series, but this is not a normal time. And so today, I guess we're going to have Theology without the tap. There's a modern Christmas carol that begins, "Have you heard the story they're telling about Bethlehem? Have you heard the story of the Jesus child?" We've all heard the story. For most of us, it's ingrained in our very selves. We have memories of the nativity scenes in church, the cribs at home. Maybe as children, I know we did, we made our own out of shoeboxes. We remember singing carols. We remember the nativity plays in which we were a sheep, or maybe we got upgraded to be a shepherd. But we never actually played Mary or Joseph unless we were the best looking child in the class. We remember midnight mass. In all of these, the story involves Mary and Joseph going to Bethlehem, probably in winter, laying the child in a manger, surrounded by animals, the angels telling the shepherds to go to Bethlehem to see the child, the wise men coming from the east, following the star, and then the flight into Egypt to escape from Herod. Apart from the fact that the only animals in the gospel story is the sheep on the hillside, it comes as a surprise to lots of Catholics that these stories, which occur only in the gospels of Matthew and Luke, aren't quite like that, as what we have done is actually conflate the two different versions. Today, we're going to unravel these stories, as it were, and attempt to penetrate the meaning of them as they would have been for the first readers and the first hearers, as well as for us today. And maybe at some point we'll find the animals. So where do these stories come from? What kind of truths do they convey? The only New Testament writers who tell us about the birth of Jesus and his family origins are Matthew and Luke. The first gospel to be written, that of Mark, begins with the baptism of Jesus by John. It tells us nothing of Jesus' beginnings or childhood. In fact, it never even mentions Joseph by name. Mark appears not to have been familiar with the stories included by the next two gospels. So why did they begin with Jesus' birth and infancy? One answer is that by the time they wrote, curiosity was growing up about the origins of Jesus. A curiosity that is underlined by the fact that much later, about the mid-second century, other writings were appearing addressing this very same question. So, for example, the Proto-Evangelium of James, and the infancy gospel of Thomas. The former, by the way, is where we get the names of Mary's parents, Anna and Joachim, and the suggestion that Joseph was an old man with grown-up children. However, this curiosity was not the only reason Matthew and Luke were writing. They were writing good news, so the stories must have been included for their religious value. The original preaching, before ever the Gospels were written, focused on the death and resurrection of Jesus. Paul, who is the earliest of our New Testament writers, tells us in Romans, the good news is about Jesus, established as Son of God in power through the resurrection from the dead. To this original preaching were added accounts of Jesus' ministry that pointed towards the Son of God as revealed in the death and resurrection. Mark begins his gospel with the baptism, and it's here that God reveals Jesus as his beloved Son. So he moves that revelation back into the beginning of Jesus' ministry, even though people don't always recognize who Jesus is. The infancy narratives take this one step back further. They take for granted Jesus' status as Messiah, Son of God, and Savior, and are written in the light of this understanding, so that in a sense, their Gospels are written backwards. Matthew focuses on Jesus' roots as son of David. Jesus is the fulfillment of Old Testament scripture and Jewish expectation, the new Moses, or Israel, come to set his people free. He uses quotations from scriptures to back this up. As many of the Jewish leaders and people of his day did not accept him and actively sought to destroy Jesus, so the Gentiles especially came to accept and honor him. And this is foreshadowed in the story of Jesus' infancy. For Luke too, the gospel stories are in continuity with Judaism and the Old Testament, but he shows this through the language he uses and allusions rather than direct quotations. Luke's gospel themes appear in the story: joy, people on the margins, peace, women, temple, the historical arena. The stories, moreover, would appeal to Gentiles, making sense for pagans who were conversant with stories of other divine beings who walked the earth, heroes who were born of the union of a mortal and a god. But here was the true divine being, the savior of the world. Both probably drew from oral traditions. Unlike the rest of the gospel material, they had no access to eyewitness accounts, no Mark's gospel to draw upon. And the major players would have been dead by then anyway. And if these stories had been current in Jesus' lifetime, his reception would have been very different. Both have points of contact which seem to have some kind of historical memory: Bethlehem, Herod, the virgin birth, Nazareth, descent from the house of David. But they're also a mixture of poetry, legend, scripture, folklore. Are they historical is really a modern question. For the original hearers and readers, the question was, what child is this? And the stories aim to answer that. Now I want briefly to turn to the stories in Matthew 2 and Luke 2. I'm only going to touch on the first chapters as necessary, as these are really our Advent stories. Matthew begins his story in chapter 1 with the genealogy of Jesus as son of David, the Messiah. It ends with Joseph, the husband of Mary. In the next verses, we have an annunciation story, but this annunciation is to Joseph in a dream, not to Mary. I often think when you look back at all the history of art, all those pictures by the old masters of the annunciation, they're all to Mary. And if you want one to Joseph, well then you have a hard time finding one. He's told the explanation for Mary's pregnancy. It's by the Holy Spirit. He takes her into his house, and when the time comes, names the child Jesus, so acknowledging him in Jewish law as his legal son. I sometimes think these infancy stories should be subtitled Joseph the Dreamer. So much of the action moves forward because of Joseph's dreams, just as Joseph in the Old Testament is a dreamer. It's notable that Matthew, quoting Isaiah chapter 7, says the child should be called Emmanuel, God is with us. And Matthew's gospel ends with the words, I am with you always. I'm going to read to you the text of these stories because it would help you to know what I'm talking about afterwards. This is chapter 2 of Matthew. The visit of the Magi. When Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of King Herod, behold, Magi from the east arrived in Jerusalem, saying, where is the newborn king of the Jews? We saw his star at its rising and have come to do him homage. When King Herod heard this, he was greatly troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. Assembling all the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They said to him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it has been written through the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, since from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod called the Magi secretly and ascertained from them the time of the star's appearing. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search diligently for the child. When you have found him, bring me word, that I too may go and do him homage." After their audience with the king, they set out, and behold, the star they had seen at its rising preceded them until it came and stopped over the place where the child was. They were overjoyed at seeing the star, and on entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother. They prostrated themselves and did him homage. Then they opened their treasures and offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed for their country by another way. When they had departed, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Rise, take the child and his mother, flee to Egypt and stay there until I tell you. Herod is going to search for the child to destroy him." Joseph rose and took the child and his mother by night and departed for Egypt. He stayed there until the death of Herod, that what the Lord had said through the prophet might be fulfilled, "Out of Egypt I called my son." When Herod realized he'd been deceived by the Magi, he became furious. He ordered the massacre of all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity, 2 years old and under, in accordance with the time he had ascertained from the Magi. Then was fulfilled what had been said through Jeremiah the prophet. A voice was heard in Ramah, sobbing and loud lamentation, Rachel weeping for her children, and she would not be consoled since they were no more. When Herod had died, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, "Rise, take the child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel, for those who sought the child's life are dead." He rose, took the child and his mother, and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was ruling over Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go back there. And because he'd been warned in a dream, he departed for the region of Galilee. He went and dwelt in a town called Nazareth, so that what had been spoken through the prophets might be fulfilled. He shall be called a Nazarene. Matthew's story isn't a particularly joyful one, as we realize when we read the text. He gives us the story of the Magi coming from the east, probably from Persia, which of course is modern-day Iran. They are astrologers. Their task is to divine the will of the gods from their observation of the heavens. Note that Matthew doesn't tell us how many there are. We think of them as three because of the gifts that they bring. Nor are they kings. But later popular designation of them as such seems to come from a reading of Psalm 72, which says, "May the kings of Arabia and Seba offer gifts. May all kings bow before him." The association of the birth of great men and great events with the appearance of stars was a common feature in the ancient world. For example, the birth of Alexander the Great. Matthew probably has in mind also the book of Numbers, where the pagan Balaam speaks of a coming king, understood to be David and later the Messiah. "A star shall advance from Jacob, and a staff shall rise from Israel." When the Magi arrive, they consult with Herod and the priests and scribes, the religious authorities, who quote the prophet Micah. But then they themselves don't follow this up, unlike the Magi, the foreigners. These are the ones, the authorities, who later on will ultimately reject Jesus. When the Magi arrive in Bethlehem, they go to the house. The implication being that the family actually lived in Bethlehem, and Jesus was probably now a toddler, because later on Herod is looking for boys 2 years old and under. The dream motif appears when they are warned to go home another way. All that follows is full of Old Testament echoes and references. The Jews look to the Exodus as the beginning of their history as a people and look forward to a new Exodus under a new Moses in the end times. For Matthew, Jesus is the new Moses, and he also embodies the new Israel in himself. So later in the Gospel, for example, Jesus gives the new law from the mountain. So here, Matthew presents us with Jesus, the new Moses, with a number of references to the Exodus and to the early history of Moses. Herod, who reigned from 37 to 4 BC, is a second pharaoh, like the pharaoh who ordered the death of the boy children in Exodus chapter 1. We have no historical record of Herod doing any such thing, although we do know he reacted violently against those who opposed him. Joseph's dream and response is a repetition of the events before the Exodus. The child Moses is hidden and so saved. Later, he has to flee from Egypt because Pharaoh seeks his death. And later, he can only return because it is said, "All the men who sought your life are dead." Moses returns and is instrumental in leading Israel, often referred to as God's son, out of Egypt. In just the same way, Joseph, in response to a dream, returns from exile. And Matthew quotes Hosea's reference to the Exodus. "Out of Egypt I called my son." Joseph returns with the family, not to Bethlehem, which is still not safe under its new ruler, but to Nazareth. No doubt because there would be work for a craftsman there in the nearby city of Sepphoris, which was being built at the time. But for Matthew, the reason is because of prophecy. He should be called a Nazarene. There actually is no such prophecy in the Old Testament, which never actually mentions Nazareth either. But probably what he has in mind is the title given to David in Isaiah chapter 11, the branch, which in Hebrew is Nezer. This is probably what he has in mind, that and also the fact that it's well known that Jesus was from Nazareth. So this story is one of birth, but it's also one of violence and opposition. Already we can see the shadow of the cross, which will bear the inscription, "This is Jesus, King of the Jews." And I think today maybe we shouldn't ignore the fact that the family, a young couple with a toddler in tow, are presented to us as losing their home, becoming refugees, and probably migrant workers. Luke's gospel is in many ways a very literary gospel. And there are a number of themes running through it: Jerusalem, temple, salvation, joy, peace, the poor and marginal people, women. All these are present in the stories of Jesus' birth. It has been said that Luke's story have a beauty which makes them the inspiration of the story and carols of Christmas for 2,000 years. Our carols especially are nearly all Lucan. When I was looking for a carol that we all know to start this presentation, I had a hard time finding one that included both Matthew and Luke's version, because all the carols were Luke's version. Luke's stories, while sharing some details with Matthew, have a quite different content and style. They contain prophecy, history, poetry, and legend. An angel and a heavenly choir proclaim Jesus as Messiah and Lord. In the first chapter of Luke, we begin in an Old Testament world, in the temple, with Zechariah and Elizabeth, and the promise of a child that harks back to stories such as those of Abraham and Sarah, or Hannah and Elkanah in 1 Samuel. The Annunciation to Mary speaks of the Holy Spirit overshadowing her, and we are reminded of the Spirit of God brooding over the waters of the first creation in Genesis 1. The Old Testament and the New come together when Mary visits Elizabeth. While the song that Luke puts on Mary's lips on this occasion not only bears a strong resemblance to that of Hannah, but also contains many of the Luke and Gospel themes. Mary returns home, and we're told of the birth of John. And now I'm going to read to you chapter 2 of Luke with his story of the birth of Jesus. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that the whole world should be enrolled. This was the first enrollment when Quirinius was governor of Syria. So all went to be enrolled, each to his own town. And Joseph too went up from Galilee to the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David that is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and family of David, to be enrolled with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. While they were there, the time came for her to have her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Now there were shepherds in that region living in the fields and keeping the night watch over their flock. The angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were struck with great fear. The angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For today in the city of David a Savior has been born for you, who is Messiah and Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find an infant wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was a multitude of the heavenly host with the angel praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels went away from them to heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go then to Bethlehem to see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went in haste and found Mary and Joseph, and the infant lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known the message that had been told them about this child. All who heard it were amazed by what had been told them by the shepherds. And Mary kept all these things, reflecting on them in her heart. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, just as it had been told to them. So Luke begins by placing the birth of Jesus fairly and squarely in world history. A worldwide, that is, an empire-wide, census at this time is unknown outside of the New Testament, and the dates of the main players don't coincide. Herod the Great ruled from 37 to 4 BC, whereas Quirinius, governor of Syria, governed from 6 to 7 AD. Luke may just be combining Jesus' birth with a vague recollection of a local census under Quirinius. As for Augustus Caesar, who was ruling at this time, he was regarded in the Roman Empire as savior and God, credited with establishing a time of peace throughout the empire, the Pax Augusta. Jesus is born during his reign. And Jesus is the true Savior and peace bringer for the world. Luke uses the census as a device to bring Joseph and Mary to Bethlehem, which literally means house of bread, which he designates the city of David, although elsewhere in the Old Testament, city of David is usually Jerusalem, but here he's emphasizing it's the city from which David, who was a shepherd, came. Now the son of David is to come from there. When Mary gives birth, she wraps the baby in swaddling clothes. And we are, I think, meant to compare Solomon, who in the Book of Wisdom is made to say, "In swaddling clothes and with constant care I was nurtured, for no king has any different origin or birth," and lays him in a manger, which Luke mentions three times, manger, manger, manger. Of course, a manger provides food, and Jesus will take bread at the Last Supper and say, "This is my body, which will be given for you." But Luke primarily, I think, has a saying of Isaiah in mind. "An ox knows its owner, and an ass its master's manger. But Israel does not know, my people has not understood." Now all of this is repealed. God's people begin to recognize the manger. And of course, here we have the animals, the ox and the ass. Shepherds lived on the edge of civilized life, including religious life, even though Moses and David were both shepherds and God is spoken of as a shepherd in the Old Testament. But here they belong to God's poor, on the margins of society. It is to these that the angel announces the birth. "Be not afraid, because this earth-shattering event, the coming of the Savior," a title used only in Luke, "can be found in a small, vulnerable human being. It is news of great joy. The heavenly host bursts into song, God's glory spanning heaven and earth. And once again, we're reminded of the original creation, when, according to the book of Job, God, speaking about his work in creation, says, "The morning stars sang in chorus, and all the sons of God shouted for joy." The shepherds go and see, and then they go back to work, as one does, leaving Mary to reflect on these things. Another Lucan theme, as his gospel shows her growing into her role as the perfect disciple. The birth stories then will move again to the temple, where Mary goes to be purified after the birth, according to Mosaic law, because in birth a woman bleeds and is then thought to be unclean, in the case of a boy child for 40 days, for much longer in the case of a woman. Jesus, as the firstborn son, is consecrated to the Lord as the law required. Luke's account is a little bit muddled at this point as regards the rituals. Something that militates, I think, against that old tradition, and that's really what it is, that Luke got his information from Mary, because she would have known exactly what went on. Also, it points to the fact that Jesus' birth is a normal human birth of a human child. Mary is regarded as unclean until undergoing this ceremony. Only much later, wanting to underline the divinity of Jesus and the virginity of Mary, does the Proto-Evangelium of James suggest it was otherwise, and it implies that actually there was kind of a flash of light and then Jesus was there. But this is a human child who undergoes a human birth. And we are back in the temple with Old Testament figures, Simeon and Anna. The gospel, of course, will end where it all began. They were continually in the temple, praising God. Before I finish, there are a few books I'd like to recommend. The first is this one by Raymond Brown. It is The Coming of Christ in Advent. I'm recommending it because he has a very good first chapter about the origin of these stories. And the rest of the book is a more detailed account of those stories in Matthew 1 and Luke 1, which I only just kind of passed over very quickly. So it really is an Advent book, but it's very good and very worth reading. And it's still in print. The second is this one by Elizabeth Johnson, Truly Our Sister. In chapter 10 of this book, she deals in some detail with the whole question of the virgin birth, which again is something I haven't really touched upon here. She also works her way through all of these infancy narratives, especially from the view of Mary. So I can highly recommend the whole book, but especially chapter 10 of that book. And then the third one is The Liturgical Year by Joan Chichester. She has several chapters on Advent, Christmas, and the Epiphany. And not only does she talk about how we celebrate them, but she tells us why we do it on those dates and where it came from historically and so on. So it's a very good background to our Christmas celebrations. But also the whole book is just excellent about the liturgical year. In some detail, so I would highly recommend that. So, the infancy narratives are literary creations with some historical details, but packed too with legendary material, dreams, visions, poetry, scripture, full of post-resurrection titles, and composed with theological intent. And I've only had time to really touch upon some of these things. By the time of Matthew and Luke, Christians were affirming Jesus recognized as Son of God, not just in his resurrection, not just in his baptism, but from the very beginning of his life on earth. But the birth of Jesus isn't the central meaning of our faith. That's the death and resurrection of Jesus. Christmas and the Christmas stories attest that Jesus, human, really did live and really did die. Christmas isn't about celebrating the birthday of Jesus, because actually we have no idea what the actual date was. But it's about the incarnation, about Jesus, Savior of the world, who became like us in all things but sin. It's a remembrance, not an anniversary. Jesus' birth was the beginning of a new creation, a life-giving event, and points forward to the resurrection. This is what the gospel writers are telling us. Jesus has entered our history. He is the meaning of life and history. Remember, we don't worship a baby. We worship the risen Christ. So from now on, in the church's liturgical year, we're going on a journey. We're going with Jesus from Bethlehem to Jerusalem. We come to Christmas looking for signs of Jesus in our own lives and age, in us and in the world around us, and especially in this troubled year and troubled world. We consider yet again how we are to commit to this person. My favorite Christmas carol, In the Bleak Midwinter, happens also to be the one voted their favorites by the British a few years ago. I don't think it's as well known over here. It has all the familiar elements: stable, angels, ox, ass, even a camel, shepherds and wise men, and envisages it all taking place in winter. The final verse goes like this: "What can I give him, poor as I am? If I were a shepherd, I would bring a lamb. If I were a wise man, I would do my part. Yet what I can, I give him, give my heart." Happy Christmas.